We are here for a purpose today. And God has called us to do many things. Build great sanctuaries, reach the lost wherever they may be found. But we're called to reach the Jewish people, to accelerate the coming of Messiah.
Well, we have a very special speaker today. It's Rabbi Felix Helpern. He is the New Jersey District liaison to the Jewish community. The district has started a brand new ministry where they're doing their best to reach out to the Jewish communities. Our Jewish community down this area is not so large, but you get up into the north, get up to Lakewood, has one of the largest Jewish communities in the United States. And so we're excited to have him. We have Reverend Jason Scalzi. Jason, stand up. Wave.
Good morning.
Okay. Mr. Scalzi, you are the better looking part of the team. Okay. Jason is very active amongst chaplaincies throughout the state of New Jersey, as well as into the Jewish ministry that's coming up. And he is ordained and the right reverend. Okay. And we're excited to have our own John Smith. John's in charge of our Shabbat here. And hopefully we want to build a little fire under some of us with regards to that Shabbat meeting. It happens once a month, and Sister Smith makes good stuff to eat for it. So we're very honored to have Reverend Helpern with us today. And so, Pastor, if you would come.
Great to be with you this morning. How many are happy to be in a place where we gather in the bond of faith and the hope eternal and the substance of our Lord Yeshua lives within us? Can you say amen to that? There is nothing better. Amen. There's nothing greater. There's nothing more enduring. There's nothing more eternal. There's nothing more life-changing. We could all say that. Because every one of us here, if we had the opportunity to share how we came to this place in faith, every story is a miracle. Because every journey there is breaking those spiritual bondages and mindsets and so forth, whether it's Jew or Gentile, we got here through a supernatural encounter through Hashem, our Lord, who sent Mashiach to this earth, Messiah. And it is an awesome time to really be alive. It may not seem that way. If you spend a little time maybe watching TV, probably all of us spend a little too much time watching that little square thing, or listening to the radio, or reading a newspaper, or wherever it may be, we are bombarded by negative things on and on and on, destruction and pain, and all the signs of the times are around us. I'm at a place often and I'm shaking my head and I say, what is going on? Because I've lived long enough now to see a former day and living in the new day. I've lived long enough to see a former reality to only try to understand our present reality. But our present reality really is something we only understand as God's people, truly. We understand the spiritual battle that rages over Israel. We understand the spiritual demonic principality of anti-Semitism. We understand where the world is going because I have the whole book. And there's a book that has yet to make its way into the mind of every person on earth because prophecies are being fulfilled as we live each day. Even as we speak, there are things going on postured in the heavenlies to come down upon this earth. And that is difficult to comprehend in the human mind. To realize that we serve this God. I so remember the words, I think often rather of the words that God said to Moshe when Moses was told to go to Pharaoh, and Moses says, "Who shall I say sending me? Just tell them, I am that I am. I am that I am." Yes, he is, always was, shall always be. And the miracle is, how do we comprehend this great I am? He's so personal because he's in us. Isn't that something difficult? How can we comprehend that spiritual process? For every Jewish person, they struggle to cross that bridge from rabbinic understanding, from Talmudic understanding, from the traditions of our fathers, and entering into a personal relationship with God. And that still, to me, is the most outstanding, precious thing that will never leave me until I breathe my last breath. How about you? So let's never get tired of who we are. Jew or Gentile, we make up the people of God and we are his agents. And the world gets intel through the agents about him. And the enemy wants to stop the intel so there's no more knowledge. And he'll do that through a variety of means. But praise God, we gather today here on this Lord's Day to worship the one true God, the God of heaven. Let me just pray before I go further. Abba, Father, from generation to generation, you have been faithful to your people. Those who call you Lord today, and those who have called you Lord in the days long gone, and those who call you Lord in the days ahead, will find great satisfaction in you, because you are most satisfying. You are our joy, our life, our well, our strength. Ruach HaKodesh, Holy Spirit, have your way in this house. Touch every heart in this place here and those that are listening by extension through video or internet or wherever they may be. Through your spirit, through your presence, as you reached into our hearts one day, reach through the systems of media, reach through the mind and heart, and transform individuals. Heal people, Father, of sickness and disease, of spirits of infirmity, in the name of Yeshua. And I pray, Father, that you would gather us together in a very tight way. Lord, your word says Jerusalem is a city compacted tightly together. Would you compact us tightly together this morning as an extended community and here as a local community and those listening? And that we would receive your heart for the end times for your people. Baruch atah atah Adonai Eloheinu melech olam hasher latan lanu hadvarachai b'mashiach Yeshua. You grant blessings, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who gives us a living word in Messiah Yeshua. And everyone said, Amen and Amen. I had the privilege this morning of being with the earlier community, and I sensed the presence of the Lord, the sweet, sweet, sweet presence of the Lord. And there is that sweet presence of the Lord here again. The Lord has, I really believe, given a very genuine spirit of a a real authenticity of who he is. You know, the world is looking for something that's authentic in us. Would you agree with that? I come to you this morning, yes, as a messianic rabbi, as a Jewish person that came to faith in his Messiah. I'm with my wife, who was raised as a conservative Jewish woman who came to faith when we first met early on in our early years of marriage. I've been married for 38 years. We've raised two daughters. And we have been on this journey of faith. But you never know where God is taking you. How many know what that's about? I never thought that I would be doing what I'm doing today. I mean, I worked for many, many years in the diamond and gold business on 47th Street in New York. I loved what I did. I really loved what I did. But I always loved God so much more. And we went into a personal revival in our life because we came to a place in our life we had lost our first love. No one knew it. We were doing all the right things. We were involved in leadership. We were doing God's work. But inside, we were barren, and we realized something has changed. And we went on a journey, and the Lord brought us into revival and swept us into a calling to the lost sheep of Israel. And at 45 years old, I had an encounter where my office was on 47th Street, and I began to weep before the Lord, and I said, Lord, you have been so good to us. You have been faithful as you have been faithful to every person. And I said, we will give you the rest of our life. And the Lord said, now I have to lead you by faith. You need to learn faith on another level. And the Lord said, you're to liquidate your retirement. You're to liquidate your savings. And I want you down to nothing so that I can reveal to you how I led Moshe and bring God my presence. So I was not all that excited about sharing that with my Jewish wife from Brooklyn, who never knew what a car payment was, who never knew what a bill was, because companies paid for everything, and I was always blessed having jobs working for companies who paid for everything. So I go home, and I begin to share this encounter I had with our Lord, and praise God, the Lord was dealing with her heart and bore witness with that. And we kind of took each other's hand, and we jumped off the cliff. You know, I believe truly in my life that I've come to realize that if you want to live for the kingdom, you discover extremes. You know, like Elijah one day is on Mount Carmel feeling very powerful and battles the 400 some odd prophets of Baal, and he looks at the most evil king in the land unintimidated. And the next thing you read, he's under a tree crying for help because his wife's after him. The king's wife is after, Jezebel's after him. To me, the kingdom is like one day we're going on the Starship Enterprise, going where we've never gone before. And the next moment, you can feel you're on the Titanic. Come on, how many can say amen to that? Maybe someone listening to this is in one of those Titanic moments. Or maybe you're in a Starship moment where you're exploring spiritual galaxies. But I've learned to be comfortable with that because that, I believe, God wants to bring us always to the edge of discomfort and bring us into new ground. And I feel like where we are today, we are in fresh, virgin soil. We planted a Messianic Fellowship in northern New Jersey. We were laboring there for 15, 16 years. And the Lord said, it's time to make a break. It's time to begin to do this. We were doing a lot of traveling. The Lord opened the door supernaturally in Asia, where we spent a number of years ministering amongst the Chinese about the Jewish roots, believe it or not, who really are understanding the one new man and understanding the Hebraic roots. And the Lord began to deal with my heart. And he said, I don't want you to travel anymore. He wants us to pour our life into this region, the second largest Jewish population outside of Israel. 3 million Jewish people reside within this region. We're all called to the Jewish people, by the way. They may not be Jewish people here, but we're called to the Jewish people as a God-given community, like we're called to every people group who live in a distant land. We sow into it in our faith. We sow into it with our finances. We sow into touching humanity in these closing days of the age. And if you believe we're in the closing days of the age, say amen, because I think everyone can understand in this hour, in the days that we're living, that to not understand it is someone who's absolutely spiritually blind and so immersed in the things of the world that they are like in the days of Noah, or the Bible says that it will be like in the days of Noah up until the last moment, and people will be planning and marrying and enjoying and doing and not knowing what is going on. Imagine Noah building the ark for 80 some odd years. Had to have been people asking him, what are you doing? Like, what's going on over there? I have to imagine that Noah shared, hey, listen, this is what's coming down here. We need to get ready. But it says no one up until the day to go into the ark. So the Lord put on our heart to begin, I felt the Lord say, I'm ready to make atmospheric changes. And I've always had a heart for the church. I've always had a value from the very beginning of understanding that God's heart for the Gentile is to bless the Jewish people. Romans 11:11, the purpose of Gentile salvation is to provoke the Jew to envy. In fact, I truly believe the plan of God is this. I'm called to love you. You're called to love me. That's the plan. I'm called to help you love me as a Jewish person and love the Jewish people and to sweep away historical misconceptions. That the heart of a Jew begins to merge with your heart and you understand the urgency of the hour so you can love them. So you have to love the Jewish people and I have to love you. Now that may sound difficult, but not really. When the Lord gives you a heart and a calling and a burden, it's not difficult. And therein is the mystery, the challenge. Do you have the heart? Do you have the burden? Do they have the identification of what God is doing in this hour? I went to the districts, I went to Springfield, and I began to share a vision for the first office for Jewish ministry. And I said to them, I don't want another ministry. I said, I'm 62 years old. I was 61 then. I don't need another ministry. I don't want another ministry. God wants to raise up an office and resource center in this denomination, and that you as the body must corporately and have the moral and the spiritual will to get behind it, because we as a denomination must be positioned for the end times. And if we are not positioned with the Jewish people, we are not ready. 7 years ago, the Lord put on my heart, as I was still laboring at the congregation, that we need the first national Jewish fellowship. In sharing in conversations with Springfield, I'm sharing my burden. I was the only voice in a wilderness sharing this, that we need an ethnic fellowship. I get a phone call from Springfield, and I said, you know what, there's a meeting of the executive presbyters and all the ethnic presidents are there. We'd like you to just come. I said, okay. Had no idea why I'm going to be there. Had no clue, was not an ethnic fellowship president or nothing, it didn't exist. I'm sitting in that conference room and I'm listening to all the testimonies of the president of the Nigerian fellowship, the Russian fellowship, all these fellowships, thousands of people getting saved, thousands of churches getting planted. And I'm sitting here and I said, you know, I feel like a speck on this carpet. I said, what do I have to share? A Jewish ministry is not measured in thousands. It's not measured in thousands upon thousands of movements of what God is planting or doing. I said, I have very little to share. But I said, God, you brought me here. Next thing I know, someone in the meeting, one of the leaders said, you know, I feel led by the Lord for the president of the Arabic Fellowship to come up and Felix Halpern to represent the Jewish people to come up. And I think they should pray over each other and he should pray over me in Arabic and I should pray over him in Hebrew. And we did that. And God did such a unique relationship, even to this day, that we have with the president of the Arabic Fellowship, that all of a sudden the Spirit of God fell in that room, that business meeting business meeting turned into a Spirit of God encounter where Dr. George Wood began to prophesy and the executive presbyters began to prophesy, and that meeting kind of went away for 2 hours. And then they gave me the opportunity to share. And I said, how can we as a denomination have every fellowship of people, every people group represented in this office and not have Jewish people in Israel represented? 6 months later, it was formed. It was a mandate. But the Lord still was stirring me for something that needed to take place on a more grassroots level. And that's really what this Center for Jewish Ministry is all about. For 7 months, I have been on a goodwill mission, loving pastors, meeting people, connecting, sharing the heart, superintendents, and every single person has said, the time is now. It's absolutely right. And so we have an office in New Jersey, in Burlington. The Eastern Spanish District wants to open up an office. In fact, this week we were contacted by someone at the American Bible Society who has a facility in Valley Forge that they were talking now of opening up the first Messianic Jewish library that gives pastors resources of what they can have, places for training and teaching young students. And this month of October, we have 3 consecutive trips to the Holocaust Museum, New Jersey District, Eastern Spanish District, New York District, 3 consecutive times in 1 month of October where we're doing a Jewish Awareness Day where we go to the Holocaust Museum and then we go to Katz Deli. It's got to be. Amen. Next year, in October or September 12th, there will be the first, 11th and 12th, there will be the first regional conference on Jewish evangelism, supported by New Jersey, New York, and the Spanish District, held at Camp Mannheim in the Borscht Belt, in the heart of the Catskills. First time ever. But thousands of people will converge upon that. We are living in changing time. The ground is shifting under our feet. Both for the good, as that's why I'm here, and then there is the bad, because we're living in perilous times. And we know that. Every pastor would say we're living in perilous times. We all can say we're not in Kansas anymore. And times have changed. So I want to share with you a little bit more about the hour, the pressing need that we have to work together. To be one, heart to heart, partnership, relationship, and to show you from Romans 11:11 that it is the mandate of the Gentile body. In fact, every believer, every church, every edifice, every sanctuary, every body that comes together, Gentile body, is a living testament to God's plan for the purpose of Gentile salvation. Is to provoke the Jew to envy. And you cannot provoke anybody to anything if you don't love them. How many say amen to that? Psalm 102 says, my days are like the evening shadow. I wither away like grass. But you, O Lord, sit enthroned forever. Your renown endures through all generations. You will arise and have compassion on Zion, for it is time to show favor to her. The appointed time has come. The psalmist is writing this out of a dark season in his life. Very dark. And he says, the evening shadow. I think about that this morning as I was meditating upon this. I feel and sense the shadow of the end times coming. I sense the shadow of the future falling upon the earth. Do you sense that, of what is coming upon the earth? Out of even the darkest times, and we may even feel that we are withering away, and I feel sometimes, Lord, until my dying day, this is what you have called us to, but when our time comes that we will wither away, the final words is, you you will have compassion on Zion. That is in my Kishkas. Compassion on Zion. All of you together, we are to have compassion on humanity, on anyone who doesn't know the Lord. Compassion for the suffering in the Middle East. Compassion for those who are being slaughtered by ISIS. Compassion for all the horrors of humanity, let alone the greatest horror of humanity, the Holocaust, of which my entire paternal line was wiped out. I was named after my grandfather, who was an Orthodox rabbi in Germany. My whole paternal line was wiped out. And my maternal line happened to be underground resistance leaders who fought the Nazis. And I feel I kind of have a blend of those two heritages, if you will. To give my life to the cause of Zion, to the liberation of the Jewish people, I'm speaking of salvation that God has called you to participate in. You will arise and have compassion on Zion, for yes, the time is now. Romans 1:16, it says, to the Jew first. That has been a very contentious scripture. I like to say now, it's to the Jew now. We won't say first, it's to the Jew now. And it is now. Our leaders, our denomination, our gatekeepers, the growth of Messianic ministry, the growth of Messianic fellowships is the one that we have here today in this house. The understanding of the Hebraic roots and the Jewish roots of faith. I always recall 20 years ago, I could not wear this yarmulke, and if I walked into church with this, I would be accused of being legalistic and erecting a wall of division, and I need to get free. Come on. I'm 62. We've been saved for many years, and most of my life has been in Assembly of God Church. I can tell you firsthand that that is true. Times have changed. And we walk in now into a church, respected, given dignity. There's a feeling of importance as to what God is doing in this hour. And God is doing tremendous amount in this hour. Russia took back Crimea. Is going to grab a hold of Ukraine. I want to take you to Ezekiel chapter 38 for a moment, because there are things pressing on us. I believe we're living in a day where blocks of scripture and prophetic scriptures are going to just come out and says, okay, look at this. It's time. Isn't that amazing that the word of God has been written to transcend time? There are passages in scripture that the future will have a different light upon. This is a day that we're seeing prophecy unfold. The word of the Lord came to me, son of man, set your face against Gog the leader and Magog, the alliance of nations. It's also called the prince of Rosh in certain translations, Meshach and Tubal, and they will form an alliance. But the Lord says that I am against you. Interesting, it's a mystery. God allows things to happen that are against his being. Babylonians captured Jerusalem. It was not his personality. It was not part of who he was, but it had to take place. God allows nations, God allows things to take place to advance his will. And this is prophesied that the prince of Rosh, Russia, the north, uttermost parts of the north, one day will have a thought, it says in verse 10 of chapter 38, one day will have a thought in your mind. You will devise an evil scheme. Many things will come in the future because the thought isn't there yet. But circumstances change in the world, don't they? Things are changed dramatically when there are shifts in power and transitions in power bases, which forms vacuums, and especially when they fit into prophecy. Hitler rose to power in a vacuum. Germany was a broken nation. Following World War I, the reparations that they had to pay to the destruction they did broke them economically. The German people lost all will, lost all hope. Their nation was crumbling. And on the scene comes a man who fills a vacuum called Adolf Hitler. He promises prosperity. He promises the glory to return to Germany. He comes in a vacuum. And so will the Antichrist. How does the Antichrist come to power? Global economic disaster, hopelessness, no answers to the problems. A man will rise upon the scene when no one else can give them the answer. He comes through a vacuum that needs to be filled. In one day, he said, thoughts will come to you. Then in verse 16, he says, I will bring you against my land so that the nations may know me when I show you myself. Yes, he's bringing them down. He's bringing Russia and the allied nations down because, truthfully, if he closes his hand on the Ukraine with his military might, there will be great economic sanctions. The European Union is one of his biggest customers. And if he does this through the economic sanctions, you watch it. Let's watch and see what transpires over the course of the next few months. Russia is headed for economic disaster. And then we will watch how nations come together in alliance with him. It's prophesied. It's going to happen. So you can imagine, as Russia is squeezed economically, one day you'll have a thought. And it says that they will come down from the north while Israel is living in safety, verse 14. You will come from your place in the far north, you and many nations with you, all of you, riding on horses, a great horde, and you will advance against my people, Israel, like a cloud that covers the land. Verse 18. When Gog attacks the land of Israel, my hot anger will be aroused, declares the Lord. In my zeal and fiery wrath, I declare that all that time shall be a great earthquake in the land of Israel. Yes, Israel, there will be an earthquake. The fish of the sea, the birds of the air, the beasts of the field, every creature. 39 verse 4, and on the mountains of Israel you will fall. And all of your troops and all the nations with you. And I will give you as food to the vultures and to the wild animals, and you will fall. And for I have spoken, declares the Lord, I will send fire on Magog and those who live in safety. Many people, prophecy watchers, Bible teachers, are watching the confluence of events to formulate the fulfillment of this passage of Scripture. So we watch, because I believe God's called us to be watchmen. The Bible says we need to know the signs of the times. We are to know the changing on the leaves. All of us do not know the day or the hour, but we do know the seasons and the times that we live. And there will come a time when this scripture will be fulfilled. But what is amazing to me over the course of the last few weeks, as I'm doing my own studies, how many people talk about the closeness of the second coming? How many people talk we're on the verge of World War III? We're on the verge of war, all tied to what's happening right now from Ezekiel chapter 38. Yet not one person that I have noticed in writings or preaching or evangelists talk about the urgency of the Jewish people. It's almost like we just jumped over our responsibility. If we are so close to the end, shouldn't we have a burden to reach the Jews, the Jewish people, to touch the harvest of the lost sheep of Israel? How can we, if we believe what we believe, if we are Bible-believing people, and I know we are, how can we not be shaken by the urgency to do something for the cause of salvation to the Jews, just like every other people group? The Judeo-Christian ethic and principle is diminishing in society. In fact, I will tell you, when people ask me what I believe or who I am, I tell them I'm a follower of the way. Because to me, the term Christian, and I know if there are Jewish people watching, they may not understand even that term, but simply it means that I'm a Jewish person who believes in the Jewish Messiah and believes in the following of his way. Because today, a Christian can do anything. Today, Christianity is marred by a gate that's so broad and a lifestyle that encompasses so much worldliness that I have to make a distinction from my life and say I'm a follower of the way, and that provokes a question. What do you mean you're a follower of the way? Let me tell you who I follow. I always get a question. Today, Christian, oh yes, you're a Christian. They keep walking. Beloved, we live in awesome days. And God has called us. I believe God, by his Spirit, is arousing us. As you were called to be, to arouse the Jew, it's another word that it says envy, arouse them to envy. I hope I can arouse you to excitement. I hope that my words, since by the Spirit only, can arouse you to the responsibility. We got to do something. Amen. We have to do something. We live in the times where Romans 11:11 is being fulfilled. It's not easy to reach Jewish people. It's a process. Every Jewish person who has come to faith will say it has been a long process. I can give you one illustration of the process. Several years ago, my wife and I were celebrating our anniversary. We have been married 38 years, raised two daughters. I asked my wife, what would you like to do for our anniversary? She said, I want to go into the city witnessing, because this is it's where God really visited us. Now, it was not particularly my choice. I thought of maybe we could have gone out for a nice dinner. But the Lord put on her heart we're to go into New York City witnessing, and the Lord put on her heart that we're to take $100 single dollar bills, and use them as tracks. Because we realized that people aren't really impressed by tracks. They don't read them as they used to. And I said, we're going to pray for every meeting and every person we go up to. We're going to hold this dollar. And I said, listen, before I give this to you, I'd just like to talk to you about, you know, it says in God we trust. Who is your source? I said, this is really for you. It's amazing how many quality discussions that we had in times to pray for people for a dollar. And people are worth a whole lot more than a dollar. And we were witnessing, and then towards late morning, we're turning up Fifth Avenue to, I believe it was 43rd Street, where the Harvard Club is located. I turned the corner, and there, God's GPS system, you know, God positioning system. The Spirit of God just locked us in to a man standing outside smoking a cigar in the middle of the block. I said, this is it. You know how that the Spirit can do that? This is it. And we knew this was a divine appointment. I went up to this gentleman and I said, sir, I'd just like to introduce myself, and I'm here to just give you this dollar to just talk about who do you trust in life. Turned out to be a Jewish doctor, a cardiologist in from Michigan. He was taking a break. He was having a conference. He was taking a break. Well, that meeting turned out to be a 2.5-hour meeting. My wife is filming it. And he began to unfold his life about how many years ago his partner, Jewish, came to faith in Yeshua, his Messiah. And his partner has been witnessing to him and witnessing to him and witnessing to him about faith. And he began to reveal all these miracles in his life, things that went on. And through all those discussions, I came to the close of this meeting and I said, Dr. So-and-so, isn't it amazing that my wife and I are here on our wedding anniversary, and we could have gone so many other places? I said, but the Lord called us here specifically to meet you so that you can connect all the dots to form your Messiah. All those encounters were points of reference that God etched into your soul that one day would formulate the embodiment of your Messiah. And we prayed the sinner's prayer. We prayed for him to finally receive his Lord. He may have been in his late 50s at that point. process, we forget that we serve a Lord who's called the Lord of the harvest. And some of us are called to plant. Some of us are called to till the soil. Some of us are called to water the seed. And some of us will have the awesome opportunity to harvest the seed. I had that opportunity and blessing to harvest that living organism, and he became a completed Jew. Metro Jewish Resources is committed, is called to raise up a body in our region through our churches and our pastors, because pastors, I believe, are the places of influence. I believe that that's how the atmosphere changes. They are the gatekeepers. I believe in government. I've always had a profound, I believe, value for government, because structure in government is his will. And when we honor government, we honor God. And through that, God's kingdom operates. And we're seeing things change. We're seeing a wind of encouragement and edification and excitement from our leaders to say, finally, we can do something that we should have been doing long ago. But it couldn't have been done long ago. Now is the time to favor Zion. Now is the time to do what God is doing. Romans 11:11. For the purpose of Gentile salvation is to provoke the Jew to envy. Just loving them, understanding them, appreciating their history. That's why we're going to the Holocaust Museum. Why? Because we need to understand history. We cannot understand the Jew until we really understand their history, because their history causes reactions, mindsets. It's the dynamics that take place in how we relate to Jewish people. So I feel like that is crucial. Romans 9:3, Paul says that I wish that I could be cut off, I'm paraphrasing, for the sake of his people. Do you know that I feel that now? That there was a time where I didn't. But I literally believe that for the sake of our people, I would consider myself cut off if that would be the thing that would do it. What a thing to say. For someone to say that I'd be willing to be cut off, if I would be cut off for the sake of my people, if that could save them, I would do that. Because the burden is so great for us, because I know the hour that we're living. This is one of the few times that I didn't bring a certain picture with me. I usually keep a picture in my pocket that the Lord really had me dig out. And it's a picture of a young boy, probably 10 years old, 11 years old or so, innocent, sweet, gentle face with eyes that just speak forth to me. And he's an Orthodox Jewish boy who was one of 6 million that were taken by the Nazis, who happened to be my uncle, who I, of course, never met. And many times I put it on the Bema pulpit. I put it here. To realize what we are doing. Matthew 23 states that unless Israel says, Baruch haba b'shem Adonai, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Yeshua cannot return. In Hosea 5:15, it says something very interesting, speaking about our Messiah. It says, I'm going back to the place that I came from until they recognize their guilt. Imagine that. Yeshua Jesus is going back to the Father until Israel recognizes their guilt. If we're so close to the second coming, man, we better get busy. We better find the ways. And you see, I believe great blessing is going to come on this. I believe it on this denomination, on our region, on our districts, on our churches. I don't say that arrogantly. I really believe that. I shared that this morning. I realized that, Lord, we're coming against so many things spiritually and mindsets. I said, Lord, I need something from you. I need equipment. I need tools. I need something spiritual. And I realize only through impartation, number one, can it happen. Number two, Genesis 12:3, I believe that when one blesses Jewish people, there's a very good chance that that person will get blessed. I believe when a denomination or a region begins to bless Jewish people and do work for Jewish people, there's a very good likelihood that that place is going to get blessed. I pray for our region. I pray for our districts. I pray for the New Jersey district. I do pray for the pastors. I say, Lord, bless them. Bless them. Untold, bless them. Release blessings on them to show, Lord, the world what happens when you come into alignment with what God has ordained. There's a release principle. I can tell you, faith is a release principle. Tithing is a release principle. Genesis 12:3 is a release principle. Obedience is a release principle. I mean, there are multiple release principles that we live under that we know with absolute confidence that God moves on behalf of those faith moves, those release moves. Can you say amen? So Paul says, hey, for the sake of my people, I'd be willing to be cut off. I feel the same way because I believe that it is the final mandate. I believe 100% it is the final mandate. We read in Revelation, I believe chapter 7, where 144,000 Jewish evangelists are raised up that bring forth the final harvest. Do you realize that when you witness to a Jewish person and he walks away and turns you down, he was maybe part of that 144,000? I mean, let's be practical. That the Jewish people that we are sharing with, what we are doing, might be seeding the future harvest in that tribulation period, even though we're gone, even though the church has been raptured, and God's dealing with certain things. Isn't that an awesome thing to believe? Isn't that an awesome thing to comprehend? I don't believe any seed. You know, Isaiah says that the seed falls from heaven. It falls like water in the snow that doesn't return, but stays in the soil and waters it to give seed for the sower and bread to the eater. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. I believe it's the same thing. I believe what this Jewish doctor is a perfect example. It exemplifies all we need to do. Get involved in the harvest. I love this part of the country, this part of New Jersey. I haven't been down here that much, quite frankly. I love to see the farmlands. I love to see the blueberry farms. It speaks of harvest, agriculture, principles of harvest and agriculture. It is no different. I'm okay myself that if I'm just tilling the soil, because I have in view what the end result is. A farmer has the ability to get out there and do that hard, physical, tedious labor and make that soil ready for seed. I think about all the preparation that's involved in that. But what is the very impetus and the very motivation, the very drive, I think, that keeps him? Because he knows that he's had a harvest. He knows the blessing of that harvest. He knows the end result. And that can bring us right back. Do we know the signs of the times? Do we know the end? Do we see the process? Do you understand? Do we understand what God is doing in our midst? Yes, we're closer to the second coming, no doubt. We're closer to the rapture, by the way. That's imminent. We're closer to a future global collapse. We're closer to the judgment that takes place in Matthew 25. We're much closer to a lot of things that are far more pressing in order of priority. And that's really what Romans 1:16 talks about. It's priority, importance. Paul never taught that word to the Romans with the understanding, reach all the Jews, then reach the Romans. Never understood that we're to reach all Jewish people first and forsake every other people group. What it really means is order of priority. What is an order of priority? Well, we understand priority. We tithe because it's a priority. When we pay our bills, I think we pay the most important bills first. We may pay our mortgage first. We may pay the electric bill first. We may pay the order of bills that are most important. How many agree? That's order of importance. That's really what it means. It's order of importance. But throughout Christian church history, it has often meant to the Jew last. It just means, let's put them on the map. It means, let's just put them on the radar. Come on, right? Let's get them on the radar because it's important for us in our time. How many agree here? There are those who are listening or watching via video may not have had ever a heart for the Jewish people. It's not natural to love Jewish people. It's not. That's why there's anti-Semitism. Jewish people have been the subject of jokes, ridicule. My wife can share testimonies of when people threw pennies at her and spit at her and treated her with absolute anti-Semitism. We live in a place in northern New Jersey, in Wayne, in a particular area. When they settled that, there was a sign on that particular area: no dogs, no blacks, no Jews. Not thousands of years ago. Today, it's mostly all Jewish now. Anti-Semitism flows much more naturally. Well, it's really supernaturally, but from the wrong side. And loving us and loving Jewish people goes against everything. God loves you and me together. You and I are greatly loved by God. The Lord has brought you and I together into the kingdom for such a time as this, and I represent the Jewish people. Our people cannot get saved without you. Your faith is a living testimony to the plan of God. For those who say that God's heart is no longer for the Jew, you have to reconcile the fact that you're here. And then you have to reconcile the fact that I'm here. And you must reconcile the fact that Jewish people have been getting saved for 2,000 years. And then you have to reconcile truth and a lie. And what true kingdom prophetic reality really is. We are here for a purpose today. And God has called us to do many things. Build great sanctuaries. Reach the lost wherever they may be found. But we're called to reach the Jewish people to accelerate the coming of Messiah. And you know, the Jewish people get this part too, by the way. You go into New York City and they have mikveh tanks that the Lubavitch have to teach other Jewish people to become more Jewish. And on their speakers saying, Mashiach is coming, Mashiach is coming, Mashiach is coming. The Jews get it, Mashiach is coming. In the Talmud, it is completely outlined the times we're living, and it says, beware of the footsteps of Messiah. They get it. And you say, well, why are you doing this? Because the more we do this, it will accelerate the return of the Lord. We can't do it just for that reason. God has to capture our hearts. Prophecy has to capture our hearts and sweep us into a move. Because I believe Metro Jewish Resources is to start a movement. That may sound melodramatic. That may sound grandiose. But that's truly the way I feel. I believe God wants to change the atmosphere and he wants to start a movement. Because I believe what God's going to do is raise up a model here that will be a model that's replicated in other epicenters in California and Florida. And one day in Springfield, we're going to have a national office. We're going to have a national office from that place is disseminated teaching, instruction, raising up leaders, raising up missionaries. Do you know we have no missionaries in New York except two people? One is 62 and one is older than I am. And I said to them, this is the best plan? This is now. There's something wrong. I'm going to get ready to close. This is something wrong here. We need to change things dramatically and quickly. And only with the Lord's help can we do that. If you're here for the first time and you're visiting, you're here at the right time. And if you're a believer and wondering if you could have, would rather have lived in another time, you're living at the best time. And if you're one of those who have not received the Lord and you're here, receive Him today and leave here today with the power of God in your life. And if you're here through video, through technology, through streaming, if you're Jewish and you have had a settling or unsettling feeling in your heart knowing there's something more, reach up to your Messiah and say, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, reveal to me my Messiah. And He'll do it. That's a request that our God will never say no to. And if you need to know the Lord and to meet the Lord today, here, do it. Just do it. There's nothing better that we can just do in our life. Because my life has changed gloriously. I'm not saying it's easy, but faith is the supernatural presence and the living reality of God. And I will live that way the rest of my life. How many of us can say that? Don't ever let your faith, your relationship get stale. Don't ever let your relationship become mundane. Don't ever take your relationship for granted. Always remember, of which the Israelites always struggled with, remember the miracles, the supernatural encounters, the markers in your life that brought you to this place today and brought you to the place of faith. And I do that often. Even with this work, I go back to the miracles. I have to. I have to go back to those. I have to go back to, they've been markers in my life. Say, Lord, You didn't bring me this far to ruin me now. You could have done it 2 years ago. You could have done it 5 years ago. God has brought many of us through many miraculous things for markers and reminders of who He is. So, my brothers and sisters, in Yeshua, God has called us together to impact the harvest. And my prayer is that this place become truly emblematic of what God is doing.
Those of you who have been watching at home, I want you to feel free to call. Be happy to pray with you. If you'd like more information about what was presented, give us a call and we'll hook you up with that information. It's an honor and a privilege to come into your home. This time I think I'm going to ask Reverend Scalzi if he'd come and dismiss us in prayer.
Father, we thank You for the words of encouragement this morning. We thank You for each and every one that is here. We pray Your blessings upon them, Lord, as we go. Bring us back tonight, Lord God. And we thank You for the peace of God that passes all understanding. We love You, Lord, for who You are. You are the great I Am. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.